Hi, this is Governor Pete Ricketts, and welcome to another episode of our Nebraska Way podcast. We're excited, as always, to be able to talk about how Nebraska is growing and more. And we've got another great guest that's going to be joining us here today, Christopher Rufo, who is somebody who's got actually a lot of background in what our main topic today, which is going to be around critical race theory. But a little bit of background about him is that he is a graduate of Georgetown University. And then you also were a senior fellow, right, at the Heritage Institute doing domestic policy. You've been a Lincoln Fellow at the Claremont Institute. You've worked also with the Manhattan Institute. And you've also are a filmmaker. You've made four films for PBS, including America Lost. You're a contributing editor to the City Journal, where you cover things like crime and addiction and homelessness. But critical race theory is one of those things you've been covering as well, right, Christopher? I got that all right?
That's exactly right.
All right. So I kind of hit the highlights on your bio. So before we get into kind of the critical race theory, and actually one other thing I left out, you live in Seattle with your wife and kids, correct?
That's right. Seattle area. Yeah.
All right. Great. Seattle area. Okay. Yeah. Good. So you're not in downtown Seattle.
No, not anymore.
All right. Good. Well, so maybe just kind of walk us through a little bit of your background. I mean, I kind of hit some of the highlights, but where I'm going to go with this is, you know, up until about a year ago, nobody even heard about critical race theory. So maybe you could just start talking a little bit about your background and then kind of bring us into how did you get interested into looking at critical race theory?
Yeah, absolutely. I appreciate it. It's great to be with you. You know, I've been doing a lot of reporting for the last 3 years on West Coast issues. So looking at homelessness, looking at crime, looking at addiction, looking at governance, trying to figure out all of these West Coast cities that are, you know, some of the most prosperous cities, some of the fastest growing cities in the country. And yet they have these enormous social, economic, and political problems. And as I was working on all this reporting, trying to untangle that, trying to figure out what policies were driving some of the successes, what policies were driving some of the failures, there was always this racial ideology at the edges. All of the government documents I requested, all of the reporting I did, all of the policy kind of papers that I went through from these very progressive cities had this ideology. It wasn't coherent, it wasn't explained, it wasn't dominant, but it was in the background. And finally, I actually started this kind of journey on critical race theory from an anonymous source who sent me a tip telling me I had to look at what was happening in the city of Seattle's Office of Civil Rights. They were training all of their employees on these kind of critical race theory principles. They were forcing them to attend a seminar called Interrupting Whiteness and Internalized White Superiority. It was a racially segregated seminar. People were being forced to kind of categorize themselves and denounce their identity. And
so I'm sorry, when you say it was racially segregated, are you saying they had white people in one of these sessions and like people of color in a different section? So they weren't mixing together, or were they like, what do you mean by like they were segregated sessions?
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it seems shocking. It seems almost impossible, but racially segregated is exactly right. These were specific training sessions only for white employees. And then you see, have it really everywhere in Seattle. The King County Library, they hold racially segregated training sessions. This is part and parcel of this new ideology of critical race theory. It resurrects all of these old and ugly ideas that we abandoned in our history, but then resurrects them under the guise of social justice. So you have this idea that you should be first and foremost identified by your race. You should be categorized by your race. And in some cases, in the public employment setting, you should actually be separated into separate facilities by your race.
Wait, are you kidding me? When you say that, is there any government entity that's actually doing that, that's separating out workers by race in their work environment?
Yeah, absolutely. It's happening in the reporting that I've done in the Seattle area alone, obviously at the city of Seattle, at the King County Library System. It's happening in some corporate workplaces and some federal agencies. This is a new theory, a new strategy. They call it affinity groups. That's the official term. Because their argument, and this is their argument, obviously not mine, they say that having white and black employees learning together, tackling these issues of race together, is both too traumatizing for black employees and also creates such a burden on black employees that white employees should be separated into their own groups so they can do the hard work of kind of a racial re-education without having to rely and exhaust people of color.
But okay, so that's for the training sessions, but what about the actual work environment? Like if I've got a call center,
is really specifically for kind of training programs in a limited way, but I think also a pernicious way, because when you open the door to race segregated employment practices of any kind, I mean, first of all, I think it's probably illegal under the Civil Rights Act, certainly it hasn't progressed beyond that, and I hope that it doesn't.
Well, actually, that was going to be my next question. It sounds like that's not even legal to be able to do it, but also based upon your response, I take it there have been no lawsuits over this yet.
The lawsuits are just starting. There's been a number of lawsuits filed this summer so far, tackling some of these problems, tackling critical race theory. But this is a new area of the law. The civil rights laws have never really been applied in this way. So it's really an open question. I feel personally confident that these will be ruled in favor of, rather against racial segregation, against racial stereotyping, scapegoating, and harassment. But again, this is a kind of new phenomenon in the last few years, and the courts haven't weighed in yet.
All right. So this is how you kind of got interested in covering this as part of all the other things you were doing around homelessness and crime and things like that. So can you, as you started getting into this, maybe just start for our viewers and listeners here, can you explain a little bit, what is critical race theory? Where did it come from? How did it get to be to the point when you were, you know, investigating some of these other issues around homelessness and crime and addiction, that all these documents really started to be having this critical race theory theme run through them? How did that happen?
Yeah, well, after my initial report on the city of Seattle, I started getting tips from tens and then hundreds and now thousands of people all over the country, not just in Brooklyn and Berkeley and Seattle and Boston, but actually heartland cities, heartland states like Missouri and Oklahoma and Kansas and other places where this ideology, to my great surprise, had been making inroads, especially in the public education system. And so my work was to digest the information, to process the documents, to do the reporting, but also to do the background research. Where do these ideas come from? What is the academic lineage of these ideas? And I found that the academic framework from which all of these training programs and school curricula derived was really textbook critical race theory. And I'll give you a definition, because I think that's really important. It's a very abstract academic field, but a definition I think that is accurate, even the critical race theorists would likely agree, is that critical race theory is an academic discipline that maintains that the United States was founded on patriarchy, capitalist oppression, and white supremacy, and crucially, that those forces are still at the root of our society today. Critical race theorists deny substantive racial progress. They argue, in some cases, that racism is just as bad, although more covert and more pernicious today, as it was 100 years ago or 200 years ago. And they believe that the Constitution, our system of civil rights, provides a smokescreen of freedom and equality, but really under our society, the core driving force is still racial oppression.
So this is kind of the basis for it. How long has this been around? Where did the genesis of this come from?
The genesis is in the late 1980s, when a group of scholars at Harvard and other elite institutions decided that they wanted to take critical theory, which is actually almost now 100 years old. It's an ideology that tries to criticize capitalist society with the hopes of overturning capitalist society. And then they wanted to apply
So Christopher, that sounds almost like Marxism, right? So is critical theory kind of based in Marxism?
It is, yeah. Critical theory is known as Western Marxism, Neo-Marxism. It's a kind of second generation of Marxist thinking. And then the third generation is really critical race theory, where they're taking the ideas from Marx, filtered through the critical theory school in the last century, and then now applying them to specifically to race. And I think the intention is that they realize that kind of this mass uprising of the working class that Marx has envisioned would never happen in the United States, where most people are satisfied with the standard of living, satisfied with the rising incomes. And then in the critical theory, kind of mid-20th century, they thought that taking over the culture was really the means of revolution. And now finally, race. And I think accurately in some ways, very shrewdly, they realize that race is a emotional, a sensitive topic. There is obviously a history of racial injustice in this country, which I think they're trying to now exploit to advance their own political goals.
So is it fair to say where Marxism was trying to create divisions within a society based upon class, right? You got the, in the classic Marx, proletariat versus the bourgeois, but we call them workers versus the managers or the owners of the businesses, trying to create that separation, that conflict, that when that didn't work out here in the United States, because as you mentioned, our free enterprise system has created a lot of opportunity for people to be socially mobile and upwardly mobile, that they decided to change tactics and get away from the class aspect and go to race, where there clearly is, as you mentioned, been racial discrimination and lots of problems with regard to race in America, but trying to create that conflict, not a class conflict, but a race conflict, again, still trying to divide us as a nation. Is that a fair assessment?
Yeah, that's right. I think the key kind of academic concept distinction is the oppressor-oppressed dialectic. So like you said, it's bourgeoisie and proletariat in kind of the old kind of classical orthodox Marxism. And now it's the racial categories of white and black. And I think that I want to be clear, because this is important, that the premise of critical race theory, that America has a history of slavery, segregation, racial discrimination and injustice, is absolutely true. I mean, that's, I think, right, undoubtable. Everyone agrees. The problem with critical race theory, where I disagree, is not their premise, not the factual basis, but their conclusions, because they deny the progress. They deny racial progress. They're skeptical of our constitutional system. They're skeptical of individual rights, of freedom of speech, of private property, and their solutions, which I think is really the critical problem with this theory, are completely counterproductive to a healthy, good, and integrated society. They advocate, in many cases, for restricting private property, suspending private property rights, redistributing land and wealth on racial lines, and limiting freedom of speech, even establishing a fourth branch of government that could suppress any speech that is not approved by critical race theorists. It is a radical and sometimes even totalitarian ideology that would subvert the entire American system in pursuit of this kind of Marxist dream of utopia. But I think that anywhere critical race theory has been tried, any institution in the United States over the last few years, it causes more division, more hatred, more toxicity, and doesn't actually improve people's lives in a tangible way.
Well, and isn't, again, my take on this is that it really is just the opposite of what Martin Luther King taught, that people should be judged by the content of their character, not the color of their skin. And this is really teaching you to judge people by the color of their skin, that you've got people who are the oppressors, people who are the oppressed. And, you know, some of the things you're talking about with regard to the abolishment of private property rights, I think, was it Professor Cheryl Harris at UCLA Law School that was talking about that? And then you mentioned about this fourth branch of government. I think that was Ibrahim Kendi at Boston University's Department of Anti-Racism. So these are not like just fringe people that are saying this. These are people that are in established positions at major institutions that are proposing these ideas.
Yeah, that's right. These aren't kind of fringe radicals kind of in a basement somewhere. I mean, these are the most prominent voices that have the most prestigious academic positions, that whose work, like in the case of Ibrahim Kendi, is in school districts all over the country. I would venture a guess that even in Nebraska, there are some school reading lists or resource lists that mentions Kendi, perhaps some of the books, his children books are maybe even assigned. This is not a fringe academic theory anymore. This is mainstream. It's being adopted by public institutions all over the country. And I think parents, thank God, are finally starting to ask questions, finally starting to take a look at what's being taught, and finally starting to take action.
Yeah, well, we're going to get back to that education thing, specifically in Nebraska, in a second, because I do have some stuff to talk about that later on. But before we get there, what I'd like you to do is, you talked about what this theory is and some of the really crazy stuff. Maybe you can go into that, what Ibrahim Kendi is talking about with that fourth branch of unaccountable government, because that, to me, is really anti-American. It's really against everything we believe in with regard to what kind of powers they have. Could you just talk a little bit about that, for an instance?
Yeah, it's a quite scary proposal. And Ibram Kendi is really the kind of guru and popularizer of critical race theory. He has a best-selling book, won a National Book Award. You know, he's been supported by pharmaceutical companies. The Twitter CEO, Jack Dorsey, gave him $10 million. I mean, this is a very prominent figure in this movement. And his proposal, you know, his description of what's happening is that any racial disparity is by definition an outcome of racism. And he says, I think this is almost a verbatim quote, but paraphrasing, the remedy for past discrimination is present discrimination. So he actually argues against colorblindness, against equal treatment under the law, against the kind of standard of judging people by their character, not their skin color, and actually says, no, we should judge people. We should tip the scales by skin color. We should have a different application of the law for different racial groups. And then his kind of key proposal, one that is actually honestly shocking that it would even get written and published in a mainstream magazine like Politico, he wants to establish a federal Department of Anti-Racism that's unaccountable to the executive, unaccountable to Congress, unaccountable to the judiciary, that would have almost plenary power. And it would be able to do two things. It would be staffed and funded in perpetuity by a team of anti-racist experts, so people like Kendi and his colleagues in critical race theory. And they would have the power to suppress any political speech that is not deemed anti-racist. So if you were running a think tank, or you were a public policymaker or governor of a state, if he would be able to regulate your speech and silence and suppress your speech if it wasn't passing the muster of these academic experts. And the second, and I think even honestly more deeply concerning proposal is that this Department of Anti-Racism would have the power to veto, nullify, or abolish any law at any level of government if it wasn't deemed anti-racist, and providing perfect equality of outcomes, which again is synonymous with an ideology from the previous century known as Marxism. And it would have the power to basically say any local law, any state law, any federal law, regardless of voter intent, regardless of its constitutionality, could be abolished and wiped away by these unaccountable experts. And, you know, this reminds me historically very much of a kind of Soviet system where you had bureaucrats that were managing the economy, that were managing culture, that were managing speech, and then they could decide based on this kind of Soviet ideology what was acceptable, what wasn't. It's totally against the American system. It would subvert our Constitution completely. And I think it should, honestly, it's frankly outrageous that something like that is even being seriously discussed.
Well, yeah, I mean, you said about Soviet system. When you were describing that, I'm like, well, this is the dictatorial powers that a communist dictator has. I mean, we've seen this before, and it's just the polar opposite of what our nation stands for and what our systems were built on. It really is shocking that this is something that is gaining any sort of attention and being something that somebody who is at a major university like Boston University is proposing and is being taken seriously on. How can, one of the things that I was on my radio call-in show and somebody asked me to define critical race theory. And frankly, I didn't give a very articulate answer about it, but I come to understand that that's how a lot of the proponents of critical race theory start. They ask you to define it rather than defining it themselves. Why is that? And how in general can people push back against critical race theory when proponents are out there proselytizing it?
Yeah, I think you're exactly right. One of the things that the critical race theorists excel at are language games. So they play this kind of hide the ball. They play language manipulation. They change the terminology. They try to confuse people with kind of this constantly changing vocabulary and set of definitions. And I think for people who want to know about it, who can really kind of intuitively understand it, but having a hard time articulating it, a very concise way of explaining it is race-based Marxism. Just say that. Critical race theory is a form of race-based Marxism. It divides the world into oppressor-oppressed based on racial categories and seeks to subvert the constitutional system. I mean, that's a very clear, concise way of talking about it. I think some of the political figures are now starting to talk about that around the country. But also, you know, don't get lost in the kind of language manipulation. If you see something, I think the most effective way of fighting against this, the reason, frankly, that I've been able to catapult this issue from almost nothing to now a national topic, is that I focused on specifics. It doesn't matter what the theory says to a certain extent. It doesn't matter what the definitions are. It doesn't matter the kind of abstract language. But if you have an example, well, they're teaching kids in California this, they're teaching kids in Illinois this, they have a book that they're promoting in now 30 states that says that whiteness is a deal with the devil. I mean, these specific examples that are based on reporting that you can find on my website, if anyone's curious that's listening, those are really the damning evidence that we need, because it takes it out of the realm of the abstract and it makes it emotional, it makes it narrative, it makes it concrete. And those are the things that actually move people to action.
And so when you're trying to push back on it, you said it's race-based Marxism. What have you found to be the most effective way to say, hey, go think about this, you know, race-based Marxism, here's what some of the things that that implies?
Yeah, I think first the couple of things are, it implies that there is an oppressor-oppressed distinction based on racial category. It implies that the ultimate aim is not a reform agenda. It's almost a revolutionary agenda. And then I think also it connotes to many people a history of utopian ideas that failed. Listen, we've tried to implement Marxist systems of government for now, you know, 150 years, you know, since Marxist, a little more than that, but since kind of Marx laid it out in the 1840s. And it's failed again and again and again. And I think that the evidence is in from the 20th century, from the Russian Revolution in 1917 to the fall of communism globally in the 1991. The communist system and a system of democratic capitalism have been tested. One ends up in bloodshed, misery, starvation, and death. The other ends up in expansion of rights, equalities, and freedoms. And Americans, the large majority of Americans, the vast majority of Americans still support our system of democratic capitalism, still support expanding freedom and equality. And I think that we just need to revive that case for our current moment.
Yeah. You know, one of the things I did is declare July the Victims of Communist Remembrance Month, with the Chinese Communist Party recognizing their 100th anniversary. I wanted to remind people that 100 million people have died with the implementation of communism in the 20th century, 65 million in China, 20 million in the Soviet Union, 2 million in North Korea, and so forth. And that is more deaths than all the deaths in World War I and World War II combined. That through imposition of communism, we had more deaths that way than in those two world wars. You know, and one other thing I just wanted to kind of hit upon too, that I thought was interesting as I was thinking about this and reading some of the things that you and other people have written about, is as this theory was kind of bubbling up, this neo-Marxist theory about dividing people by race, there was also the civil rights movement in the 1960s. And doesn't that really, I mean, that really kind of won out in the 1960s and really showed that our system, our constitution, again, certainly we've got work to do with regard to race here. Racial injustice is a real thing. There were things that I was not taught in school that I should have been taught, but that the civil rights movement really demonstrated with you know, 1964 Civil Rights Act and so forth, that we do make progress here in this country, and it kind of beat out this neo-Marxist theory. Is that accurate? Is that fair?
I think that's right. And my reading on the history of it is that in many ways, critical race theory is a reaction to the disappointments with civil rights. I think that if you look back at the 1960s, you had the Voting Rights Act, the Civil Rights Act, you had the War on Poverty, you had this very optimistic sense that that by extending a kind of colorblind equality, that it would do the work of kind of healing racial division, allowing people to make a progress in this country. And I think to a large extent it did, but certainly there are still gaps. There are still inequalities that I think we need to grapple with in a serious way. But the critical race theorists took that lesson of the Civil Rights Act, not as a kind of stepping stone or building block, but they actually said, see, a kind of colorblind equality, equal treatment under the law doesn't work. It doesn't provide equality of outcomes. So we need to go back into history and take the more radical ideas from people like Angela Davis, the Black Panther Party, the Communist Party USA, that kind of ferment that provided a kind of alternative to the civil rights movement. And they're now reviving some of those old ideas. And You know, I think it's just, I think it's a mistake. I think that if you want to look at racial inequality, I wrote a paper for Heritage Foundation about this. If we adopted critical race theory, I argue, and I think persuasively, that critical race theory's policies would deepen racial inequalities rather than reduce them, because they reject the idea, in many cases, of the nuclear family. They reject the idea of enterprise, of hard work, of entry-level employment, giving people a step up the ladder. And they also reject merit-based or achievement-oriented education. And look, when you take poor people of any racial background, including African-Americans, including white Americans or Latino-Americans, whatever, and if you undermine family, if you undermine merit-based education, you undermine the idea that hard work is the path to success, you are going to trap people in poverty, in desperate conditions. And unfortunately, this utopian vision, if you just break down the system, something better will emerge, doesn't prove to be true.
Yeah. In fact, just the opposite of what we've seen in our real world experience with communism. So it was a lot of your reporting on this that actually got to the Trump administration, and President Trump then signed an executive order on this. Can you talk us a little about how that came about?
Yeah, it really emerged last summer. I did a series of reports on critical race theory in the federal government. They kind of took on kind of explosive growth, got a lot of attention. Then I went on Tucker Carlson, who's been very generous, kind of having me on his show for the last few years. And then I did something very simple. I laid out my research. I called on the president to say, hey, look, they're promoting an ideology in your administration that is contrary to your values, your principles, your priorities. And to the president's immense credit, not only was he watching Tucker, but then instructed his team to take immediate action. And within 3 weeks, it went from the segment on Tucker Carlson to an executive order that was signed, sealed, and delivered. And that really, I think, elevated this debate, because it took this debate, which was formerly really an academic debate, and now made it a political debate. And I think that we shouldn't shy away from that, because in our country, politics is where decisions get made. We make these big decisions through the political process. And that was a really huge step in this program.
Yeah. So now the Biden administration has come in and they've reversed that executive order. Is that right?
That's right.
Yeah. So what else have they done, have you seen, in the Biden administration that would be promoting critical race theory?
Well, this is actually kind of a very interesting thing. The first day in office, Biden rescinded Trump's executive order. Since then, especially through the Department of Education, Miguel Cardona, the education secretary, huge supporter of critical race theory, they've been trying to weave critical race theory into all their materials. And in the last 2 weeks, they've done two things. One is that they had originally planned to tie federal K-12 grants nationally to the implementation of critical race theory in schools. They also created a kind of booklet or a resource guide for all public schools in the country for reopening that also included some of the most egregious critical race theory materials. But here's the thing, Governor, that I think is really exciting. To both of those, there was such an immense backlash from the American people saying the Department of Education should not be federalizing critical race theory, Department of Education should not be tying critical race theory to reopening schools, that the Biden administration walked back down and scaled back both of those proposals, because they've seen in the last 6 months that critical race theory is political poison. It's toxic. It's opposed by a huge majority of Americans. So I think we should be not celebrating victory, but we should be celebrating an incremental victory that we've pressured the administration to back down on critical race theory, at least in this recent period of time.
Now, the federal government's not the only place that critical race theory is being used to create training programs or things like that. Corporate America has also been involved with this, and you did some specific reporting, for example, on Raytheon, the second largest defense contractor. Talk to me a little bit about that, and what are we seeing in corporate America?
Yeah, and this is in many ways a kind of surprising twist on the story. I've done reporting on Disney, which had a very aggressive critical race theory-based program. Lockheed Martin, the biggest defense contractor. Raytheon, the second biggest. I have in my archives and my upcoming stories a series of the largest global banks and financial institutions. And in one sense, it's strange because they're taking on critical race theory, which seems to be, you know, opposed to capitalism. And yet these are the big capitalist enterprises. But I think there's really two explanations. One is that there's a certain amount that this is just a kind of trend or fashionable thing among HR professionals. And then I think it's also, unfortunately, a form of insurance or if you want to put it in kind of the organized crime metaphor, it's a form of a payoff or a protection racket, where these companies trying to defend themselves on their left flank, defending themselves from people on the kind of left wing who might come after them on taxes and regulation, they can say, well, hey, look, we are a quote unquote anti-racist company, or we are a company that promotes these ideologies, so we're the good guys. And I think it's a distraction mechanism. It's a protection mechanism. It's a really cynical ploy to signal these cultural ideologies to protect themselves on their left flank. While I think that in almost every case, the folks that I've talked to is, you know, these aren't really, in most cases, deeply held beliefs. This is a kind of cynical defense maneuver from these big companies.
So maybe you could talk a little bit about what some of these programs, though, for the people who work at these companies go through, because it may be something that the companies are doing to kind of defend themselves from their left flank, as you talked about. But what do the people actually have to go through when they're taking these classes or in these workshops?
I mean, some of it is quite terrible. I mean, the first thing that I think that I see significantly in many of these training programs is that they really elevate race to the most important element of the individual. They want your group identity to be kind of the determining factor. They provide different set of rules of behavior and engagement and speech for different racial groups. So they'll sometimes very explicitly say, like in Raytheon, this is how white employees should speak to black employees. This is how black employees feel, and this is how they process the world in these very reductive and stereotypical categories. And then in some cases, like at the Sandia National Nuclear Laboratories that I reported on last year, they actually have what I think are race re-education programs where they take employees, they tell them that they have, in this case, segregated by race and gender, white male employees. They also did segregated programming at Lockheed Martin, saying that you have white male privilege, you are a kind of white male oppressor in the larger framework, that's the suggestion, and that you need to atone for your racial and gender identity by essentially denouncing yourself, apologizing, doing a series of exercises to disrupt your internalized whiteness. You see these themes across a lot of different companies. And I think it's really stereotyping, it's scapegoating, it's discriminating, it's segregating. It's this workplace pattern that I think from the folks that I've talked to in my reporting, both white employees and also black and other racial minorities employees, they say, we don't want to do this. We want to get the job done. We work well together as a team. And these programs are really awful, reductive, stereotypical, and they create more division. And we don't like it, but we're scared to speak out.
Yeah. And it would almost seem that if you are a minority, that it almost would be patronizing on some of this, that in some of these things to say that, you can't talk to a black employee a certain way because they're traumatized or something like that. Do you hear any of that from the people you're talking to?
Yeah, that's right. I think it certainly, yeah. I mean, a lot of the minority employees that I've talked to, they say, it wants to present us as the kind of eternal victim, oppressed, traumatized, having no agency, having no capabilities, needing to be coddled, needing to be treated differently than my other colleagues. And I think the fear from minority employees on that side of the equation that I've heard over and over is that it gives a sense that we shouldn't be judged on our merits. And, employees have told me, hey, we work very hard. We meet our expectations. We're excellent employees. But these kind of programs stimulate the idea that somehow we shouldn't be judged on our merits. We shouldn't be judged on our contributions. We should be judged by our racial identity. And especially for people that have worked very hard, they say, hey, look, I have 3 engineering degrees. I have a PhD. Right. I'm the top in my field. The idea that I should just be, the kind of minoritized employee in the office is really offensive, really patronizing. I've heard that from a number of people.
Yeah, that's kind of exactly. Especially when you've got somebody who's got that kind of educational background. One of the things that, I don't know if you follow this at all, University of Nebraska, one of the members of our Board of Regents has introduced a resolution that would basically prevent the imposition of critical race theory. And of course, the academics are all in an uproar saying, hey, this is, freedom of speech. We have to have academic freedom and that sort of thing. But I think really what they're missing the point is that with critical race theory, that actually shuts down freedom of speech. It shuts down academic freedom. And the point of this resolution, in my opinion, is to really make sure that voices are being heard, that people who oppose critical race theory are not being shut down when they express that opposition. Can you talk to me a little bit about that? I mean, am I off base here on this with regard to what critical race theory would do? You mentioned before about, you know, Ibrahim Kendi and his fourth branch of government that wants to abolish laws and shut down, you know, suppress speech from politicians. Wouldn't that same thing be applicable, say, to a university campus?
Yeah, I think there are really two segments that we've seen in legislation or board resolutions that are important to distinguish. There's K through 12, first of all, so public K through 12 schools. You know, the state legislature, the state board of education has really very vast powers of regulation on what's in the curriculum, what's not in the curriculum. That's a no-brainer. We've seen now nine states pass board of education or legislation restricting the principles of critical race theory, the practices of critical race theory in K through 12 schools. At the university level, it becomes a bit more nuanced, a bit more delicate. There is certainly some scope for academic freedom, for teaching in the classroom, for people's research interests, but that's not unlimited. And I think the point is, and the First Amendment really, we have to remember, and this is something unfortunately people have forgotten, the First Amendment is designed to protect citizens from the government, not to protect the government from citizens. Right. And the University of Nebraska, the public education system, even the public higher education system, is funded by taxpayers, it is chartered by taxpayers, and ultimately it is governed by taxpayers. So there is a limit to these. This is not unlimited freedom. For example, if a University of Nebraska professor wanted to go out on the street corner in his or her own time and shout critical race theory, you know, from the top, that's fine. You have a right to that. But the university system does not have an unlimited right to promote an ideology, and certainly does not have an unlimited right to compel the speech or compel the beliefs of students. I think the people of Nebraska ultimately have authority over how their public institutions are run, which values they transmit, and if they are controverting the values of the public, certainly they have the opportunity through their Board of Education to step in.
Yeah, and then one of the things I want to also hit upon is you talked about, we're talking about the university level, and you said how it's more nuanced. And of course, you know, at universities, we do have a lot of dialogue around different ideas and so forth. One of the proponents or some of the things I hear from proponents of critical race theory is like, well, you know, this is not something that is being pushed in our K through 12 schools. But to me, it seems like it's just the opposite that it is. You mentioned it a little bit before, but you know, for example, we see that the National Teachers Union came out and said that they were going to push critical race theory in all 14,000 of their school districts that they, you know, represented. The Nebraska Department of Education on its website lists resources of the 1619 Project. When I criticized critical race theory and saying it was against core American values, one of the leaders of the 1619 Project tweeted back at me that racism, white supremacy, actually what she said was white supremacy is a core American value. And this is a resource that's listed on our Nebraska Department of Education's website, along with the Zinn education process. And Zinn is a self-proclaimed socialist. So we do see these things that are going into our school system. I'm wondering if you've got other examples from the K through 12 school system about how that's being pushed and what should parents be looking for in the curriculum? You know, what question, kind of questions should they be asking when they want to know more about what is being taught in the K through 12 schools?
Yeah, I mean, it really is obviously a disingenuous argument that it's not in public schools. That's actually the plan. If you look at the academic work of the critical race theorists, they're very explicit. They say we need to get our ideas in the public education system, in K through 12 schools. This has been the plan since the late 1960s. And now they're getting these kind of subversive ideologies and pedagogies into K through 12 schools. I've reported personally on school districts all across the country. I have dozens of stories. You can find all of those that I've actually created a briefing book for parents and legislators. It's called the CRT Briefing Book. You search my name, CRT Briefing Book, you'll find it. So there are many, many examples. It's a deliberate. Now the unions are now endorsing it explicitly. They're kind of the cat is out of the bag. But I think it's really important for parents to understand that the principles of critical race theory and the practices of critical race theory are often not labeled critical race theory. I mean, this is obvious, right? I mean, you can have some ingredient in your dish that's not labeled in the name of the dish. But I think there's a series of linguistic sleight of hands, linguistic Trojan horses that parents should be on the lookout for. And I think that this isn't to say that this always means critical race theory or critical race pedagogy, but I think it should at least raise a kind of red flag that parents should say, I'm going to take a closer look. Anything that says diversity, equity, and inclusion, anti-racism, certainly anything that says something like whiteness, white privilege, white fragility, equity rather than equality. These are all buzzwords that, again, don't necessarily mean critical race theory, but certainly are correlated in many cases with critical race theory principles. I think that's the way that they do it. The kind of game that they play is that they have these very kind of nice euphemisms, words that no one can disagree with. Well, I support diversity. I support equality. I support inclusion. Those are all great. But if you look, if you kind of pop the hood and you look actually what's inside, you'll find the more pernicious concepts. And these are things like white fragility, white privilege, white people are racist.
Yeah, Christopher, could you explain a little bit for maybe some of our listeners or viewers here, what is white fragility? What does that term mean?
Sure. So I'll kind of back up and explain the key terms. So there's this idea that there's this force of whiteness in the world, that white people, so in this case, Americans descended from Europeans, can be reduced to a racial essence of whiteness. They can be defined by this racial property that provides a kind of, that is oppressive, that is exploitative, that is racist. And then from that concept of whiteness, they have a variety of sub-concepts. One is white privilege, the idea that if you are born with light-colored white skin or of kind of white racial background, that you are by definition privileged no matter what your class background, family background, or personal characteristics or character traits. There's this idea that white fragility, that white people are so fragile when they speak about racism or injustice that they actually become kind of neurotic and kind of break down into rage and denial and all these kind of syndrome of bad psychological traits. And then there are, even the idea that is very crude, but there's this idea in critical race theory that all white people are racist. That's actually a direct quote from the critical race scholar Barbara Applebaum. She says, all white people are racist. Or Robin DiAngelo, the author of White Fragility, says, white identity is inherently racist. So this idea that, you shouldn't be judged on any of your behaviors or actions or ideas, you should be judged by this kind of racial essence, is really core to what's happening. And unfortunately, these ideas are in school districts all over the country. And they're not just saying, hey, governor, your white fragility is showing, you're white privileged, you're an adult, you can kind of handle this, you can debate it. They're actually taking these ideas and they're imposing them on kids as young as kindergarten. Wow. In Buffalo, New York, in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, in Cupertino, California, in Seattle, Washington. In all of these places, these ideas are being promoted to kids who, frankly, still believe in Santa Claus.
So what can parents do? What have you seen parents being able to be successfully pushing back on this?
Absolutely. And that's been honestly the thing that keeps me up every morning, bright and early, fighting hard, being inspired, is that the greatest resource in the United States are parents and families. Parents and families make the world run. They're invested in the future. These are the people who are leaders in our community, and they have been on fire in critical race theory. We've seen parents protesting at school board meetings, parents running for and winning school board seats, and parents lobbying their state legislatures to take action in all 50 states. We've now had a tremendous energy on this. And you see these viral videos of parents saying, hey, wait a minute. I don't want my kid to be determined as oppressor or oppressed. I don't want them to be judged by their racial category. I don't want neo-Marxist ideology kind of ruining my child's sense of agency and possibility in this world. And parents are successfully pushing back. The fight is not over. It's just beginning. But parents need to get involved. And there's really three steps. First, get informed on what's happening in your local school district. Ask the teacher, ask the principal, if necessary, file a Freedom of Information Act request. Get the actual information of what's being taught, what's being promoted. Second, show up at school board meetings. We have a great system of decentralized control in this country. There are 14,000 local school boards, but they only work if there are parents invested in holding them accountable. Show up at the meetings, and if they're not doing the right thing, run for school board and beat them. Critical race theory is an 80-20 issue in most of these districts. so you can find success there. And then third, in our democracy, in our constitutional republic, the power to shape public institutions lies ultimately with the state legislatures. So go to the legislature, demand action. Tell them, you know, other states are doing this. These are the best practices. Texas, Florida, Oklahoma, New Hampshire, not just deep red states, but even New Hampshire, which is kind of a purplish state, are now passing bills to restrict these pedagogies. And there's no reason that we can't have these in 20, 25 states across the country.
Yeah. And I think it's fair to say that there's certainly a lot of opportunity to improve the education we've got in this country on a number of different levels. But particularly when you're talking about racial justice, when I was in school, we learned about the Civil War and slavery, but specific things like in Omaha, Nebraska in the early 1900s, 1920, you had Will Brown, who was lynched by a mob. You had the Tulsa race, massacre in the same time frame. So there are certainly things that are not being taught in our schools that really would help us understand our history of racial injustice. But that doesn't make the leap to what you're talking about here with critical race theory, right?
That's right. And I think that my own personal preference, and I imagine many people share my view, is that it's essential to provide honest and accurate history and to go back at those ugly and unjust moments in our history. There are plenty. I mean, any society has issues. We should be honest and accurate. We should explore it fully in a rich and contextualized way. But I think that we should always keep in mind and contextualize our history within the framework of America's highest ideals of freedom and equality, and then our progress towards achieving and realizing those ideals. Because I think that provides a sense of narrative progress, narrative development, narrative movement. And it doesn't provide this kind of hopeless kind of litany of horrors that can make students feel like their country is irredeemable, their country is fundamentally racist, their country can never be improved. You have to say, hey, look, these are the horrific injustices in our past. This is how we overcame them. These are our highest ideals. These are even in many cases how we're not living up to them today. And this is the unifying force that brings people from every country and every corner of this earth to come to the United States to participate in our great experiment. It's driven our country to tremendous heights, to tremendous progress. And I think we need to have that infectious enthusiasm and inspiration for kids, especially kids who are maybe from kind of marginalized background, vulnerable backgrounds, to show also those hopeful stories. I mean, we have a kind of like Robert Woodson, the great Black scholar and activist, has this collection of stories of Black resilience, Black excellence. Why aren't we also telling those stories? Why aren't we telling all of these incredible stories of overcoming racism and hardship and injustice? That's the kind of spirit that I want to see. That's what I want my kids to learn. That's what I want all kids in this country to learn, is honesty about injustice, but always in the framework of our highest ideals.
Yeah. And so I want to hit upon something that you'd talked about a couple times now, the difference between equality and equity. Just kind of hit upon that, because I think it kind of wraps up a lot of this stuff that we've been talking about throughout this entire podcast.
That's right. And I think that, as we've been saying, this is a language game. Equality and equity are almost homonyms. They sound nearly identical, but they're very, very different. So equality, the American principle of equality, is the idea that everyone has individual rights and everyone should be treated equally under the law. And that our system should be a system of non-discrimination. That's the kind of American principle of equality. The principle of equity is very different. It rejects the idea of individual rights. It says there should be group identity-based rights, so that we should look at people not as individuals, but as racial groups or categories. It rejects the idea of equal treatment under the law. It rejects non-discrimination. It says, no, we actually should treat people differently under the law based on race, to rectify past injustices, which I think is a noble intention, a noble sentiment, but actually the counterproductive in many ways and the wrong way to go. And then ultimately, this is the real dangerous part, is that equity states, not equality of opportunity, not that we should try to get people roughly on the same playing field, roughly able to pursue the maximum of their potential, but says, no, equity means equality of outcomes. From each according to his ability, to each according to his need. I mean, that's really what it boils down to, which is basic kind of 19th century Marxist equality of outcomes. Everyone should end up at the same place. regardless of their behavior, regardless of their aptitude, regardless of their capabilities. It's unjust unless everyone is equal in their outcomes. And as we've seen and as we've discussed, and as I'm thankful you highlighted, looking at the victims of communism, that idea, which sounds very good, it sounds very simple, it sounds in some ways very achievable, in the real world of practice, is a total nightmare.
Yeah, it ends up and oftentimes making everybody very, very miserable and poor.
Yeah,
so right. We're kind of coming to the end of our time here. Just, is there anything else that we didn't cover that you want to wrap up on?
Yeah, I'd like to just encourage everyone, both state lawmakers, local lawmakers in the state of Nebraska, as well as parents and school board members, to check out my Critical Race Theory briefing book. You can just search Christopher Rufo, CRT briefing book. It'll pop up on Google. This is really a handbook that gives people a sense of what critical race theory is. What are some of the stories that you can tell about how it's hurting children and damaging institutions? And most importantly, how to speak about this issue when you advocate against it. I think that's really what we need. And again, I appreciate the time. I appreciate everything that you're doing. We stand ready to support you in all your efforts.
All right. Well, hey, thank you very much, Christopher. I appreciate your time with us here today. Is there any way that, or do you have anything that you want to tell our viewers and listeners here about how they can find out more about you or anything like that, how they can follow you on social media?
Yeah, I'm at Real Chris Rufo on Twitter, and my website is ChristopherRufo.com.
All right, great. Well, again, thank you very much, Christopher, for joining us. And thank you to all of our listeners and viewers for joining us again for another edition of the Nebraska Way podcast. As always, you can like us on Facebook. You can follow us on Twitter at @GovRicketts. You can follow us on Instagram. There's a number of ways. Of course, you can always send me an email, pete.ricketts@nebraska.gov. We certainly encourage people to reach out and let us know what you think. Again, thank you so much for spending your time with us to be able to hear Christopher talk about critical race theory as something that is being really pushed in a lot of different sectors and certainly in the news quite a bit. So we really appreciate it, you taking the time to listen to the podcast. Thank you all again. And we look forward to our next episode of the Nebraska Way.
Thank you.
Paid for by Pete Ricketts for Governor, 1610 N Street, Suite 100, Lincoln, Nebraska, 68508.